Hey guys, what's going on? This is John from Friends with Your Benefits. You may have heard me mention in a previous video that lifestyle spending accounts, also known as LSAs, can be really effective at attracting and retaining talent for employers. But did you guys know that LSAs can also be used to help employees on their well-being journey? Joining us today to learn more about that is Suzy Goodwin, account executive at Forma. Hey Suzy, how's it going? Welcome to the show.
I am really excited to be here, John. Thank you.
Oh, of course. So Suzy, just to, I guess, inform our audience a little bit more, right? Can you tell our viewers one fun fact, maybe two, about yourself?
Yes, I will. And it's got nothing to do with lifestyle spending accounts. It's actually got more to do with how I like to model healthy behavior. Okay. And that's through running. Actually, I'm a triplet mom. And when you're a triplet mom, you've got, if you want to run with a stroller, you guessed it, it becomes a triple running stroller. So picture baby, baby, baby. In 2016, I had been running with that triple stroller, and I knew that I was pretty decent at it. The kids liked it, and decided to, as part of a fundraiser for the NICU, where they spent their first 2 months of life, I set a Guinness World Record for.
Are you serious?
Yeah. Oh, I'm serious. I'll do a drum roll for you. Da, da, da. the title is, or was, because it's since been broken, to be fair. Okay. But I set the Guinness World Record for fastest half marathon while running with a triple pram female.
Yeah, that's just something else. Well, congratulations on that. And I have to say, that's the first time we've ever heard anything like that on the show. So kudos to you, Suzy.
Thank you. Thank you. That is my 5 minutes claim to fame, but I've actually been in the corporate wellness space for over a decade now and know a lot more about well-being than I do stroller running. How's that?
Fair enough. So speaking of well-being, many employers out there and many clients of mine, to be totally candid, do have well-being programs in place, and many of them do involve a premium differential, right? So maybe if an employee before open enrollment starts, perhaps they get an annual physical, they complete a health risk assessment, they get a discount on their premium dollars, and maybe it's $50, $100 a month, what have you. And some employers have really seen a lot of success with that, but others, the programs have kind of stagnated. So really want to hear from you in terms of what employers can do and how LSAs can fit in the mix as well.
I would say first and foremost, John, for anybody that is thinking this, I would ask you to consider, is that premium differential yielding behavior change or compliance, right? Because that's two different things. Compliance is, yes, I did my attestation, I did my biometric screening or my HRA, right? Sure. Behavior change is, I'm at point C in the journey, and by next year, I got to D or E. Mm-hmm. And so, is, you know, carrot or stick? And we know that stick yields action, but is that compliance or change? And may I tell you kind of a story in the realm of this?
Absolutely. Yeah, go from there.
So I cut my teeth as a tobacco treatment specialist. I worked for a point solution. This is over a decade ago, and that's how I began in this space. So I was a telephonic wellness coach, and I was the person that when someone attested, yeah, I'm a smoker, in order to get their premium discount, right, they would need to talk to me every few weeks or months, depending on where they were in the care plan. John, if I had a nickel for every employee who said they were a smoker and they weren't, I might be able to cover your premium, because here's why. We worked with a lot of manufacturing environments, and we worked in a lot of environments that they didn't get the break if they weren't a smoker. So if I'm a smoker, and I get 2 15-minute breaks extra 5 days a week, and I work for a year, I mean, add it up, right? Yeah, I'll hang out on the phone with this health coach. And so it's compliance, but it's certainly not behavior change. And I'm giving you something to illustrate like just how bad these things can go. But even to the lightest of this, right? Even in the, you know, hey, I'm working with someone on nutrition, or I'm working with someone on physical education, because that's kind of what I was flagged for. is it yielding change?
Walk me through that, right? So let's, obviously you have that great background in tobacco cessation, and that was definitely an awesome story. So how do LSAs actually fit in the mix?
Right. So LSAs, of course, they're different from a traditional wellness program because it's personalizing that wellness benefit at scale. If I'm the benefits manager for 1,000 employees, there are 1,000 different personal needs. Yes, everybody is a special snowflake. If I actually want their health to change. And we know, right? When people make those healthy changes, when we're actually getting the people who might be at risk for chronic disease, not keeping the healthy healthy. I'm talking about these people that are at risk, not yet costing a lot of money.
Yep, that's fair.
Or maybe like pre-diabetes territory, or they've got high blood pressure, but they're not on meds yet. If those people can actually change and you use the tools, right, that are designed for them. And what I mean by this, John, is now you just heard me say, oh, Guinness World Record half marathon.
Right.
I'm keeping the healthy healthy in my organization. Okay. But you know what? It wasn't always like this. In fact, I had not a freshman 15, but more like a freshman 25. And so as a new employee, if somebody would have said, you know, hey, your wellness program is to be a gym rat, I might have said, a hike, bro.
Yeah, right? Sure. Like, that's fair.
Absolutely. But if wellness is intentionally broad to meet me where I am, and in this example, I'll use maybe a habit building app so I can be in my safe space at home, or maybe working with a personal trainer because I don't know what in the world I should do when I get in the gym. That dumbbell terrifies me. It opens it up to everyone. And again, when I say stage of change, health behavior nerds are going to know, and you've got to know, I'm a certified health education specialist. So that's the awesome. Health behavior nerds know that this means, okay, when is somebody going to change? Are they contemplating a change? Are they thinking about changing in the next 30 to 60 days? Are they in a change? Are they keeping up with that change? Their health behavior will define these things for you. Takeaway for benefits, folks, though, is there are specific actions that each person is going to be open to, and they can't all be met with a one-size-fits-all benefit.
Sure. So I've heard within the LSA space, right? Like, obviously, you mentioned fitness, and I believe that like the Peloton app or your Peloton subscription would be available. But you know, to your point, that would help satisfy the gym rats out there, but perhaps not everyone, right? So could things such as yoga or maybe, let's say, getting healthy groceries, could that be eligible for an LSA?
Absolutely. So for example, my organization in our marketplace, we have Instacart. And I'll tell you, I'm a triplet mom. Let me tell you how much that helps. That helps the new parent that might be in an organization. So yes, not only something like a grocery delivery, but also like a meal planning tool. I talk habit building tools. My Bible app has a pay option. That's under my company's policy considered a habit building tool. Now they're helping me with my spiritual health, right?
Right.
And so that's part of well-being. Exercise, you know, home exercise equipment, yoga equipment, yoga classes. Now I don't have to go to the big box. I can support my local mom and pop business. And I can do that, right? Because with a lifestyle spending account, it's intentionally flexible. It's flexible to personalize at scale.
Definitely makes sense there. So what are some of the unique things that you've seen LSAs use for in the past?
Man, I love what Zoom does. Zoom has an account specific to helping employees reduce their carbon footprint. And the reason why, so this is for like EV charging, things like that.
Okay.
I love this because it's consistent with their overall mission of being a sustainable company. At the employee level, right? Now we're contributing to the mission at large. Another organization, Allbirds, they have a really great program for new parents. It's called Baby Birds. Get it? Allbirds, Baby Birds. It's called Baby Birds, and it's for those additional expenses that new parents have. So I'm talking about diapers and wipes. I'm talking about baby monitors. It's a nice fund for new parents. And of course, most organizations are giving that maternity parental leave. And it's wonderful to see companies thinking more innovatively about that. But what about all these expenses that new parents are not used to? It's sticky, so it helps with attraction and retention. And then also it's doing right by the employee in that meaningful moment in their life.
Absolutely. So one thing that I hear, right? So we're in the strategy meetings and candidly out there, we're starting to talk about 2024 with some employers out there. And we talk about LSAs and Suzy. They're like, this concept is awesome, right? And they say, hey, John, what's this going to cost me? And they see, and depending on the size of the employer, it could definitely be over $1 million per year. How do you overcome that objection?
You know, I would say when folks are in this kind of whiteboard season, there are a few things to consider. And John, I'm not going to tell you, oh, overall, you'll end up spending less, because that doesn't help anybody watching this video that's trying to get an audience with their finance team. So let's acknowledge, and it's understood that like it will save money over time, but I know that's not what somebody needs to get that budget. So first of all, I would say, do you have any wellness funds from your medical carrier? This is something that in recent years, it's kind of seemed like monopoly money or phantom dollars, if you will, because there are so many rules attached to actually spending said dollars. But I think most LSA organizations, to include mine, will do custom invoicing and help design a policy. That way you've got an expert helping you get through all of that red tape, design something that's in bounds, and help you use those funds on the platform fees. Can I offer something else?
Yes.
Okay, good. I also want to mention too, so my organization did a conjoint study about benefits in general. And if you're not familiar with that design, or your viewers aren't familiar with that design, conjoint is kind of like it's like a choose your own adventure way to do research. So depending on how you answer a question, right? If you answer it different from me, we might get different second and third and fourth and so on questions. So it was about ROI of benefits. It was about like, what is the perceived value of these benefits? And in this conjoint study with over 300 participants, LSA came in second behind 401k matching with less than a
10%
differential. Yes. Huh. I'll send you the link.
Yeah, that'd be really cool to hear. I honestly wouldn't have thought that, but good to know.
Second, and knowing that it was that conjoint design too is really powerful. Another thing that study brought out is that when we're thinking about perceived value, you've got a 50% increase on perceived value when you offer employees choice. So in this study, it was $2,500 worth of benefits. Yep. And so the employee sees that, right, as 50% more when they have choice versus 2,500, and these are the buckets that we say it goes into. So thinking about just the financial environment that we're in, the economy that we're in, if I've got a benefit that I know employees will be perceived as more, right, and there might be some ways to do this in a cost neutral way, that is another good thing.
No, I think that's really cool, Suzy. So definitely went over a lot of information here, and thank you for all the tidbits there, and really didn't honestly know that LSAs would be number two in that survey that you mentioned. So obviously whiteboard sessions, right? Let's say there's an employer out there who wants to learn more about lifestyle spending accounts, and perhaps they want to connect with you. Where can they go to learn more?
Awesome. So I am all over LinkedIn. I love some LinkedIn. I'm Suzy Goodwin there, Suzy H. Goodwin. My organization is called Forma, and our website is Join Forma. John, we've got an amazing ROI calculator that will help anybody who is in these starting areas. Naturally, you know, I love my organization, and I hope we'd be a great fit for anybody, but I think any org that you go with, this is a really good starting point for getting an audience for budget, and then also understanding the policy design and how you might approach that as well.
Well, Suzy, thank you for coming on the program today. Really appreciate it.
Thank you, John.
Thank you. And for our audience out there, we want to hear from you guys. Is LSA something that you'd consider in the future? And if so, what would you like to include in your LSA program? Comment below.